Hello friends, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anurekha Chari Vag, Assistant Professor, Department of Sociology, Savitribai Phule, Pune University. Today we are going to discuss a module titled Bhudan Gramdan Movement. This module is part of the paper titled Agrarian Social Structure and Change. This paper is coordinated by Dr. Manish Thakur of IIM Kolkata. In this module titled Bhudan and Gramdan Movement, we will first initially focus on the history of the movement. Further, we will focus on the concepts of Bhudan, Gramdan and Sampatidam. In this module, we will also explore the political philosophy of Bhudan movement, and we will also conceptualize Bhudan as a movement. Further, at the end, we will also look into the outcomes of the Bhudan, Gramdan movement, especially in the context of rural transformation in India. Inspired by the Gandhian ideals of rural reconstruction, the Bhudan movement was initiated by Acharya Vinoba Bhave in 1951. It began with the initial objective of securing voluntary donations of land and distribute it to the landless and disadvantaged sections of the society with a view to remove land-based inequality in society. The inspiration for Bhudan came to Vinoba ji when he was touring the tribe-torn Telangana region, Hyderabad, in 1951, which had witnessed violent clashes between the local peasants who were led by communists and the landlords in the wake of a revolutionary peasant uprising that began in 1947, which had led to both loss of property and lives. Bhudan Gramdan began as an experiment as a non-violent radical recasting of the Indian social order in general and agrarian hierarchy in particular. Through Bhudan, Vinoba Bhave aimed to demonstrate to the peasantry that there was an efficient alternative to the communist program of violent insurrection. The first land of Bhudan occurred in Pochampalli in the village Nalagonda district of Andhra Pradesh, where Vinoba appealed to the landlords on behalf of the landless lower caste of the village to do something for them. While responding to Vinoba's call, C. Ramachandra Reddy offered 100 acres of land to Vinoba in order to fulfill his late father's wish. This event convinced Vinoba that many more people could be convinced to act in this manner too. He realized that Bhudan could provide a lasting solution to the problem of social inequality owing to the unequal land distribution that exists among groups in our countryside. Subsequently, Vinoba and his followers traversed the length and breadth of the country in padayatras. The movement was off to a good start, and according to an estimate from 1952 to 54, more than 3 million acres of land were received as Bhudan. The largest part of this land was collected from Bihar in 1953, a state to which Vinoba ji shifted his headquarters from Hyderabad. However, the movement came out with a demand for 1/6 share of land from all owners. By 1952, the movement had widened into a Gramdan village as a gift and started advocating the collective ownership of land. The Bhudan movement started in 1951 and continued till about 1969. In fact, there are two phases into which this period has been divided, that is from 1951 to 57 and then the second phase from 58 to 69. Vinoba travelled nearly 80,000 kilometers all across the length and breadth of the country. The movement received official support from the government at the center as well as in several states gradually. Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru supported the movement by creating legal provisions for legal transfers of land. The state governments adopted legal arrangements for accepting the gifts and for subsequent redistribution. For example, in Orissa, the Orissa Legislative Assembly passed Orissa Bhudan Yagna Bill 1953, according to which a Bhudan Yagna Samiti was established in Orissa. The Samiti had the authority to receive the land gifts and redistribute the land to the landless people. Between 1951 to 57, the Bhudan movement was at its peak. According to an estimate, total Bhudan collections in Orissa amounted to 1,22,000 acres. This soon gave way to form that Gramdan or donation of the village by the time Vinoba started his Padayatra. This was a definite shift as it affected the program of land gift donations, which gradually dwindled and was overshot by the Gramdan movement. By the end of 1960s, 1946 villages were gifted as Gramdan in the state out of the total 4,500 Gramdans made in the entire country. Bhudan, Gramdan and Sampatidan. The renunciation of private property on a mass scale through Gramdan was the next stage and probably the most significant aspect of Bhudan movement. The call for Gramdan in 1952 and subsequently expanded to block Dan in 1966. Ziladan in 1967 and in 1971, the movement, which then was concentrated in the state of Bihar, was striving for Bihar Dan. as the movements are to consolidate itself into attempts at rural reconstruction, the scope of donation increased to other kinds of wealth, sampatti dan, other kinds of gift like shram dan, donation of labor, buddhi dan, gift of intelligence, jivan dan, gift of one's life, etc. Two were introduced in order to secure cooperation of men with varying resources and dispositions. Sampatti dan movement is distinguished from the bhudan movement in the sense that while the latter aims at redistribution of land, which is the basic means of production in agriculture, the former aims at redistribution not as a basic means of production such as factories but of income derived from these capitalist owners. C.G. Shah opines that this invests the program of Sampatti Dan with bourgeois class character. It does not ask a capitalist to surrender the property which enables them to exploit the workers but appeals to them to set aside a portion of the profits born out of this exploitation for relieving the distress of the poor. In other words, it endorses private capitalist property in the means of production. Mangroth in Harimpur district of Uttar Pradesh was the first village to come out under Gram Dan. Subsequently, it took 3 more years to get another village as a gift. The second and third Gram Dans took place in Orissa almost 2 years later. Subsequently, the movement started spreading with the emphasis of village as gift as Vinoba Bhave to the state in 1955. In fact, Vinoba's Padayatras resulted not only in reaching the message of the movement to far-flung corners of the state, but also gave the movement a fresh lease of life. Village has to take 3 interlinked steps in order to become a Gramdani village. The villagers opting for Gramdan should agree to transfer the title deeds of all the land in favor of a legally constituted village assembly, Gram Sabha. The village assembly, Gram Sabha, should be constituted beforehand, and the village fund, Gram Kosh, has to be created, meant for social welfare measures and economic development. Gramdan had to start with Gram Bhavana, or awakening of social consciousness among the villagers, followed by Gram Sankalpa, or the creation of community determination to accept a way of life oriented towards sacrifice and sharing. Gram Sankalpa would lead to the generation of Lok Shakti, people's power, and this in turn would give birth to Rajniti, or people's polity. It is expected that a new environment is hoped to be created at the center of all activities and efforts. Chaudhary, for example, mentions 4 aspects of Gram Sankalpa taken in a Tamil village consisted of 4-fold pledge: to give land to the landless, to eradicate untouchability and casteism, to take to khadi and village industries within a stipulated period, to have basic education in society. This, what lies beneath these efforts as Gram Dham, was particular moral vision of a definite social transformation. The workers of the movement felt that it was limiting to a place an exclusive emphasis on securing land donation and distribution. This led to a shift in emphasis to a larger goal of the Gram Sabha in 1963. Therefore, along with Gram Dan, the program of building a Shanti Sena, peace brigade, and developing village-oriented khadi were included within the scope of the movement for rural reconstruction. This came to be known as the triple program or the Trivyut Karyakram. Vinoba Bhave thought that the best way to pay homage to Mahatma Gandhi in his birth centenary would be to lay the foundation of Gram Sabha in every village by 1969. But this program did not gather momentum as expected. Concept of Gramadan had to be redefined around 1965 because such a radical measure was not welcomed by the landed in general. Therefore, instead of an equitable distribution of land, it was thought to be satisfactory if all landowners parted with only 1/20th of the land for distribution to the landers. Landowners were permitted to retain their inheritance rights over 1/20th of their land. This new arrangement was defined as Swalabh Gram Dan. The goal was rationalized as 1 step backward in order to secure 2 steps forward. According to Oomen, in effect, the notion of Swalabh Gram Dan amounts to a substantial change in the goal orientation of the movement, a tendency towards the decline of the movement. Sarvodaya ideology laid at the base of the Bhudan Gramdan movements. Sarvodaya meant the upliftment of all. A direct offshoot of Mahatma Gandhi's constructive program, the ideological paradigm of Sarvodaya sought to create a stateless and classless society by establishing the principle of sharing voluntarily. The Bhudan movement tries to develop Gandhian concept of trusteeship in industrial activities. Sarvodaya was based on certain cardinal principles such as ahimsa, non-violence, satya, truth, asthya, non-accumulation, sharir, sharma, physical labor, aswad, regulation of taste, sarvatra, bhaya, virgin, total, bhaya, virgin, total fearlessness, sarva, dharma, samte, equal reverence for all religions, vadeshi, using indigenous products, and so on. These values are sought to be inculcated through the institution of Dan, which is defined as equal sharing. Further, it was seen that the values of Sarvodaya were not totally against industrialization, but it is in favor of regeneration of village society and economy. It did not stand for an economy of abundance, rather advocated an economy of self-restraint and frugality. Extending the notion of trusteeship of Mahatma Gandhi, Sarvodaya ideology argued that while everybody had the right to produce unlimited wealth, no one has a limited right at the level of consumption. In other words, man is the owner of his wealth in a nominal sense, but in reality he is a trustee of that wealth. While consuming, man must relate to his poor neighbors who have little. Ideology also wants to avoid the evils of mass society and hopes to evolve a group which includes all adult members of a society who are incorporated into the local decision-making process, thereby signifying the formation of a participatory democracy. The ideology of the Bhutan movement also attempted to create the self-reliant power of the movement, which Vinoba believed was superior to that of the state. The self-reliant power could be honed by practices like Vichar Sahasan, which meant the readiness to understand other points of view without imposing one's views on others. Further, Kartitya Vibhajan, or the distribution of work among individuals without creating an administrative bureaucracy, was another such exercise through which vested interest of people could be avoided. However, the latter was rather difficult because without an organizational base, the programs of a movement cannot be pursued. So even in the Bhutan movement, a number of regional local organizations came up to coordinate the activities of the movement at different levels. This has no doubt affected the charismatic nature of the movement. In what sense was it a movement? According to T.K. Woman, the Bhutan movement was a charismatic form of movement, judging from the manner in which Vinoba intervened and the land donations took place. The fact that Harijan families requested him to obtain land for them, and the way in which he appealed to the gathering of the people, the fact that his appeal was answered, all this made him wonder and believe that God gave him a signal to undertake this work. God wants his land, India, to make a successful experiment in a non-violent social and economic revolution. The first land donation took place in an atmosphere of awe and mediation, inner inspiration of the donor and the faith of a leader in God. Vinoba, the initiator of the Bhutan movement, was hailed as a saint by the masses. His appearance, behavior, and austere ways created respect among men and women, and he was regarded as a holy man. Rajendra Singh termed Sarvodaya and Bhutan movements as new social movements that constitute a new paradigm in society, in the sense that they actively articulate generally universalized, mostly pacifist, non-violent, pan-humanist, and homophilic values. The Bhutan movement as such declined the values lived on in the ecological movements which emerged in the decade of 1970s and after. Bhutan movement involved large number of people in the task of social reconstruction. As the goals of the movement expanded over time, it brought in large number of volunteers who were keen to be involved in various capacities in this mammoth task of reconstruction. Different kinds of activities were taken up, like the expansion of khadi and village industries, demand and expansion of literacy at the local level, the management of local resources through cooperatives, distribution of agricultural implements and collective farming, to name a few. Village laboring on development projects are encouraged to save a part of their earnings to build up a village fund. Gramdham opened up unlimited possibilities for soil conservation, crop planning, land management in general. Thus, the distinctiveness of the Bhutan movement lay in the method that it employed, as well as the way in which it imagined rural reconstruction. The communalization of land was probably not a novel idea. No movement so far had relied on the idea of voluntary gift of land, wealth, and intelligence for bringing about sweeping changes in the structure of society. The uniqueness of this means advocated by Vinoba added to the charismatic appeal of the movement through its unique missionary manner of intervention did not take away the various individual vested interests which managed to mar the charismatic appeal of its leader. Outcomes and assessment. Though the Bhutan movement was unique in many respects, it failed on several accounts. According to Daniel Thorner, a fundamental aspect of Bhutan was that its appeal was directed to the rich and the landed and not to the poor and the landless. When Bhutan campaigners marched into the village, these landowners made a good show by giving away few patches of land that were careful to retain securely within their grasp the holdings and the associated economic operations upon which the control of the village rested. Landowners who form the core and the Indian villages do not own all land, but most of the land they own is often the most valuable in the village. Bhudan movement could not break the stranglehold. In Bihar, it turned out that much of the land was donated was rocky, barren, or otherwise agriculturally poor, was under disputed disposition. In Orissa, too, most of the villages gifted in the movement was located in the so-called tribal areas of the state, the areas which were in the least need of land reforms. It is alleged that the record distribution of land collected by the movement was poor. Bhudan movement not only failed to garner enough land for the landless, it failed to adequately distribute what was collected. According to an estimate, Orissa, which was in fourth place in the country as far as collection of land was concerned, very less land was redistributed. In many cases, as opinion by Shukla and Angal, landowners and villagers were willing to consider parting with a parcel of land that they really held in excess, but parting the entire holding and then accepting a small part as private and the rest as common was not acceptable to the most. Out of respect for Vinoba Bhave, villagers agreed to give the land on paper and backed out. On the other side, the availability to cultivate and at least produce some amount of output per unit of land depended upon the capacity to control and invest in inputs. But in reality, the landless did not have access and control over the inputs other than family labor. Therefore, the viable utilization of Bhudan land could not be achieved. The immediate objective of the Bhudan was economic and ameliorative in character. In other words, material incentives in the form of special loans and grants are given to Gramdan villagers. All these led to the stepping up of donations, particularly Gramdan donations. Now the leaders of the movement claimed it was essentially a movement directed by moral cause. Women's study shows that most of the participation in the movement were motivated by material benefits which might be due to the ameliorative character of the movement. This affected the charismatic nature of the movement. According to Shukla and Angar, one of the causes of the breakup of the movement was the movement was sidelined by mainstream intellectuals. The communist activists were also critical as they did not agree on the approach. Government agencies were also negligent and inefficient on following up on the legal and administrative support that were required to firm up the distribution of donated plots of land. Further, although at the level of ideology, organization and authority were abhorred in Bhudan movement for the purpose of realizing the goals of the movement, a number of organizations at the regional and the local level were established to coordinate the activities at the village, district and state level. At the India level, Akhil Bharatiya Sarva Seva Sangh coordinated the activities of the movement. This was another factor that affected the charismatic orientation of the movement. In 1975, Indira Gandhi imposed a state of internal emergency, suspending the right to protest and dissent. By then, the movement had retreated into history, leaving behind a possible paradigm of social reconstruction. In India, Sarvodaya had emerged as a form of inclusivist mobilization with its humanist values, inspiring social movements, which emerged after 1970s. In mid-1970s, Jayaprakash Narayan, a well-known socialist and political leader, was drawn to the Sarvodaya ideology and gave a call for total revolution. There continues to be serious discrepancies in the tenure of terms of the land claimed to have been distributed and the amount of land that has been claimed to be have been gifted. For example, a recent report of the Bihar Land Reforms Commission on Bhudan, Government of Bihar 2007, underlines a basic problem as reconciliation of area of land so far denoted and recorded in the books of Bhudan Yajna Committee. The figure according to the committee was 6,48,476 acres, out of which 2,55,347 acres had been donated to 3,15,454 families. According to the committee, about 2,78,320 acres of land were found to be not suitable for distribution because of alleged improper physical characteristics of land. That apart, the committee still had in its books an area of 1,14,708 acres suitable for distribution, but had yet not been distributed. This figure itself is a telling comment on the achievements of the Bhudan movement. Moreover, in Bihar itself, the physical characteristics of over 2.78 lakh acres of land are such that they have been declared unfit for distribution. No one knows as to what who had verified this land, what are the methods verification were followed. Excepting hills, forests, rivers and structures in the public domains like roads, hospitals, waterways, schools, the rest of the land should be available for utilization for farming, horticulture, grassland farming, tree farming, as waste stands to be developed under various schemes of the government. To declare such a huge area of land as unfit for distribution, then carry out the whole area in the books as the potent source of local disputes and social tension. Sadly, a movement that sought to mitigate social tension in the countryside ended up acting adding up to the existing rapporteur of land related disputes. It is also a source of corruption and misuse of public property. Not surprisingly, the verification of actual physical characteristics of this large area remains unfinished task. Above mentioned report mentions that figures of land given in donation area, confirmed area, distributed area unfit for distribution, number of beneficiaries in different categories maintained by the Bhutan committee and that maintained by the revenue department of the government of Bihar do not tally in respect of various categories. Such discrepancies have to be reconciled in the books maintained by both the officers, failing which they have to be reconciled to actual field verification. Without such verification, the possibility of lands being utilized by unauthorized persons, including land mafia, cannot be ruled out. The primary objective of this campaign would be to reconcile the figures maintained by both the officers. Throughout, there has been a lack of coordination between agencies associated with Bhutan movement and the revenue department of the state. Thus, Bihar Land Reforms Commission, which had the mandate to inquire into the reasons behind the failure to achieve the intended objectives and contemplated targets under the aegis of Bihar Bhutan Act, states that our country witnessed serious agrarian unrest immediately after independence. Our country witnessed serious agrarian unrest immediately after independence. Acharya Vinoba Bhave started the Bhutan movement requesting large landowners to donate land so that poor landless workers could get some land to make a living. The main point of the movement was to provide for the settlement of such land with landless persons. That would satisfy the land hunger of poor and bring about peace in the countryside. Unfortunately, much could not be achieved due to inefficiency both on part of the Bhutan Yagya Committee and the Revenue Department of the government. Friends, in conclusion to the module titled Bhutan Gramdan Movement, we need to understand the relationship between the failure of land reforms and the Bhutan movement. Further, we also had focused on how rural reconstruction was taking place through the whole idea of Bhutan. Further, how the ideology of Sarvodaya had played a very important role in shaping the whole idea of Bhutan movement. And we had also focused on the idea of charismatic leader, which was seen in the role of Vinoba Bhave, inspired by Gandhian ideology. At the end, we have also focused on how the Bhutan movement had led to great transformation, especially social transformation of rural India of the past.